will arise and go now and go to Innisfree and a small cabin build there of clay and wattles made. 19 rows will I have there, a hive for the honey bee, and live alone in the bee loud glade. And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the vales of the morning to where the cricket sings. There midnight's all a glimmer, and noon a purple glow, and evening full of brilliant wings. I will arise and go now, for always night and day I hear lake water lapping with low sounds of the shore, while I stand on the roadway or on the pavement's grey, I hear it in the deep harp's roar.
William Butler Yeats was born in 1865 in Dublin. His father had been trained as a lawyer who became a painter. So he was raised in a bohemian world in Dublin and London. His mother's family were business people in the town of Sligo on the Atlantic Ocean in the west coast of Ireland. And the whole family decamped for Sligo and a little town called Ross's Point every summer, where Yeats ran wild through the countryside. It was there, talking to country people who were not speakers of Gaelic any longer, but were much closer to that old Gaelic culture than he was, that he realised it wasn't just a beautiful and a wild countryside, but it was also a countryside that was, for these people, alive with legends, with stories from ancient Irish mythology. On Sligo Bay, with Knocknarea, an ancient site of Irish mythology to the south, and the looming Benbulbin, about which Yeats would write in later life so much, to the north. On the top of Knocknarea, as you look up from Sligo, you can see a cairn of stones. And under those stones is reputed to be buried Queen Maeve, the greatest heroine of the ancient Irish mythological cycles, one of the heroines of ancient Irish history and mythology. And all of the landscape in Sligo is infused with that, like a mythological past. And Yeats, as a boy, as a teenager, talking to the peasant people around Sligo and hearing stories about that Irish world, was fascinated by it. You know, inspired by talking to people in the villages around Sligo, there are a whole set of poems. The Ballad of Father Gilligan, and perhaps most famous of all, The Fiddler of Dooney.
When I play on my fiddle in Dooney, folk dance like a wave of the sea. My cousin is priest in Kilvarnet, my brother in Muhar Bui. I passed my brother and cousin. They read in their books of prayer. I read in my book of songs I bought at the Sligo Fair. When we come at the end of time.
This is a poem about Knocknarea, and the she is the Gaelic word for the fairies, for the ghosts of the old ancient Irish heroes, who he imagines riding as a host, a crowd, across the mountaintop at Knocknarea. The hosting of the she. The host is riding from Knocknarea and over the grave of Clúna Bear, Cuilse tossing his burning hair, and Niamh calling, away, come away. Empty your heart of its mortal dream. The winds awaken, the leaves whirl round. Our cheeks are pale, our hair is unbound. Our breasts are heaving, our eyes are agleam. Our arms are waving, our lips are apart. And if any gaze on our rushing band, he will come between us and the deed of his hand. In his early life,
we find Yeats writing some of his most beautiful work, and especially his most beautiful love poems. Almost all of these are written to one woman, Maud Gonne. Maud Gonne was considered one of the great beauties of her day, and Yeats, young man, on meeting her, immediately fell in love with her. But Maud did not reciprocate or return Yeats's love. The more she spurned him, the more she found other lovers, and she did, the more passionate Yeats became and the more beautiful the poems that he wrote about her. Maud may not have been good for Yeats's life, but she was wonderful for Yeats's poetry.
When you are old and gray and full of sleep and nodding by the fire, take down this book and slowly read and dream of the soft look your eyes had once and of their shadows deep. How many have loved your moments of glad grace and loved your beauty with love false and true. But one man loved the pilgrim's soul in you and loved the sorrows of your changing face and bending down beside the glowing...
When I was a student in the Iowa Writers' Workshop, I fell under the influence of a man who became my mentor, Frederick P.W. McDowell, who was a lecturer in English literature, or as they called it in those days, British literature. And I read the poets from 1800 through around 1945, and of course Yeats was a major figure in this period. I loved the great mature poems that everyone reads in the various anthologies, of course, but I really, what struck me most were the magical early poems, the Wild Swans at Cool, the Lake Island of Innisfree, the Song of the Wandering Angus, and particularly the Stolen Child, the kind of magic that inheres in the landscape of Ireland, which I felt very much when I lived there, not long after I got out of graduate school. I lived there for a bit. And I feel that, and that musicality of the Irish literature, the Irish myth, and its attachment very closely to the landscape really touched me and lit me up and were what helped me decide that that would be my focus in my PhD, that period anyway.
I went out to the hazel wood because the fire was in my head and I cut and peeled a hazel wand and hooked a berry on a thread. And when white moths were on the wing,
and when white moths were on the wing, and moth-like stars were flickering out, I dropped the berry in a stream and caught a little silver trout. When I had laid it on the floor, I went to blow the fire aflame, but something rustled on the floor, and someone called me by my name. It had become a glimmering girl with apple blossoms in her hair, who called me by my name and ran and faded through the brightening air. Though I am old with wandering through hollow lands and hilly lands, I will find out where she is gone and kiss her lips and take her hands and walk among long dappled grass and pluck till time and times are done the silver apples of the moon, the golden apples of the sun.
What Yeats was good at doing was casting even her refusal of him in the most heroic terms. In other words, he was determined, and he turned his determination into his passion. How can I blame her, he wrote, that she filled my days with misery? A beauty that is not natural in an age like this. being high and solitary and most stern. He refused to blame her, but he didn't refuse to taunt her at a distance. And this produced some of his most magnificent love poems. Who will go drive with Fergus now and pierce the deep wood's woven shade? Young man, lift up your russet brow and lift your tender eyelids made and brood on hopes and fear no more. And no more turn aside and brood upon love's bitter mystery. For Fergus rules the brazen cars. So there you have it. Love's bitter mystery is what he calls it. Perhaps for him it was, why does Maud refuse me? What it really means, Fergus, from ancient Irish mythology, is there in the shadows behind us. In other words, as Irish people, with that heritage, with that background, with that history, we know passion. The world is becoming modern and dull. People are moving to the cities. People are living a 9-to-5 existence. And who can escape that modern rat race? Yeats, writing at the very moment when that rat race was beginning, was naming the Irish as the people who, just because they were Irish, had a right to something grander, to something more noble, to a beauty that is not natural in an age like this. So that's the first phase, as we might say, of Yeats's passion. Let me now talk about the second. Partly incited by Maud, but of course also watching and seeing what was happening all around him in Ireland, Yeats became, in the second phase of his life, much more involved in Irish politics. These were, of course, the revolutionary years.
Early in the 20th century, entering a new phase, Ireland itself, partly inspired by Yeats and the other writers of the Gaelic revival, roused by them towards a new sense of the power of their Irishness.
With a woman named Augusta Gregory and a number of other friends, he set up the Irish National Theatre, which produced plays about the changing Ireland and the young Irish people who were demanding, once again, independence from Britain.
As he became an organiser, at least of cultural events that might inspire people to go and fight in the revolution, he also began to look around him in the country. And at first, he was incredibly disillusioned. His attitude was basically something like, look, I have been writing for years, trying to instill in you some passion, some sense of the grandeur of your Irishness. And what are you all doing? You are just going about your ordinary, dull lives. And he found that sort of disgraceful. And this led to a whole series of poems, of which the most famous is called September 1913.
What need you, being come to sense, but fumble in a greasy till and add the halfpence to the pence and prayer to shivering prayer until you have dried the marrow from the bone? For men were born to pray and save. Romantic Ireland's dead and gone. It's with O'Leary in the grave. Was it for this the wild geese spread the grey wing upon the tide? For this that all that blood was shed? For this Edward Fitzgerald died? And Robert Emmett and Wolfe Tone? All that delirium of the brave? Romantic Ireland's dead and gone. It's with O'Leary in the grave.
It's got some of Yeats's great lines, you know. All that delirium of the brave. I mean, that's a sort of formula for what he wanted. a kind of almost noble madness that courage might bring.
'Twas down that glen one Easter morn, to a city fair rode I. There Ireland's lines of marching men in squadrons passed me by. No pipe did hum and no battle drum did sound.
W.B. Yeats was sitting in an elegant drawing room in London when the news arrived that those young people in whom he had so little faith in 1913 had marched out and launched the rebellion of Easter Monday, 1916. And in truth, he was amazed. He was even more amazed a couple of months later when news came that the leaders of that rebellion, who after a week of fighting in Dublin had surrendered, were being executed one after another by the British government. And at that moment, he sat down and he wrote his most famous poem.
Easter, 1916. I had met them at the close of day, coming with vivid faces from counter or desk among grey 18th century houses. I passed with a nod of the head or polite meaningless words, or have lingered a while and said polite meaningless words, and thought before I had done of a mocking tale or a jibe to please a companion around the fire at the club, being certain that they and I but lived where motley is worn. All changed, changed utterly. A terrible beauty is born.
From cloud to tumbling cloud, minute by minute they change. A shadow of cloud on the stream changes minute by minute. A horse hoof slides on the brim, and a horse plashes within it.
Was it needless death after all? For England may keep faith for all that is done and said. We know their dream, enough to know they dreamed and are dead. And what if excess of love bewildered them till they died? I write it out in a verse, McDonough and McBride and Connolly and Pierce, now and in time to be, wherever green is worn, are changed, changed utterly. A terrible beauty is born.
Yeats, indeed, in his best spiritualist manner, gets to be like the high priest announcing this national birth. A terrible beauty is born. You know, he says, I was wrong about the Irish in September 1913. They are not just ordinary and mundane. They are capable of passion. They are capable of incredible sacrifice. After Ireland became independent, he managed to buy in County Galway a castle as a great bargain, restored it, and he went to live there. And he produced a whole set of poems, which are published indeed in this book, called The Tower. We see his fear that passion will turn into a kind of violent anarchy, for example, in poems such as The Second Coming. He found himself suddenly Ireland's national poet, sort of the grand old man of Irish literature. In 1926, he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature. An amazing part of the story is that his own passion for Maud Gonne never really abated. Maud Gonne also had an affair and lived with a man in Paris for some years and had a daughter named Isolde. When Isolde grew up, she looked just like her mother, and Yeats, now a middle-aged man, began to write poems to her. When he realized that all of these battles were lost, he himself finally married a young English woman named Georgie Hyde Lees, and soon after he won the Nobel Prize. And together they had a family. At this point, we enter what we might imagine as the third and perhaps the most brilliant phase of all of his poetry.
A prayer for old age. God guard me from those thoughts men think in the mind alone. He that sings a lasting song thinks it a marrow bone. For all that makes a wise old man that can be praised of all, oh, what am I that I should not seem for the song's sake a fool? I pray, for word is out and prayer comes round again, that I may seem, though I die old, a foolish, passionate man.
What interested Yeats at this time in his life was all the passion that he had written about worth it? And what indeed would he be leaving behind? He took at face value, very seriously, the way in which his body was growing old. In one of his most beautiful poems, he starts off, "This is no country for old men. The young in one another's arms, birds in the trees, those dying generations at their song." He said, "An aged man is but a paltry thing, a tattered coat upon a stick." And he says, "What was my passion worth? I expended it on what? Only to become this, a kind of old scarecrow." But what's great about him is he never gave up. From the beginning, all through his career and his different phases, he calls on the Irish to express that kind of passion that they could bring into the modern world, which tells us all at the end of the day to be dull and ordinary. He told them always, no, be passionate. One of his very last poems is entitled Under Ben Bulbin, and it's always put as the final poem in any anthology of Yeats's work. Controlling to the last, what Yeats does there is he writes his own epitaph and tells the people of Ireland where he is to be buried. The place was to be back in Sligo, under that mountain that looms over Sligo Bay, Ben Bulbin. In the churchyard at the bottom of Ben Bulbin, as he said, "that my body be laid." All he wanted was a simple stone.
Yeats wrote his own epitaph before he died, in which he once again stresses his personal unimportance. Well, when I lived in Ireland, I made a little pilgrimage to Sligo so I could see this very thing. I have a picture of me. "Cast a cold eye on life, on death, horsemen pass by."
What a strange line for such a passionate poet. Cast a cold eye on life, on death?